Antony Phillipson is the United Kingdom's Trade Commissioner for North America. Commissioner Phillipson, welcome.
Thank you very much. It's great to spend some time with you.
Commissioner, how do you view the future of trade between the United Kingdom and the United States in the post-Brexit era, with a particular emphasis on the possibility of a new bilateral trade agreement between the two countries?
Well, we've been working at this for a while now with our US colleagues. Ever since the UK voted to leave the EU back in the summer of 2016, the British government has been clear on its intention to negotiate an FTA with the US and indeed with others. So we've begun processes with Japan, Australia, New Zealand, and we're also looking at the possibility of joining the CPTPP, the Trans-Pacific Partnership, as was. With the US, though, we've always been very focused. It is already our most important export partner. We're the biggest investors in each other's country. And it's just fundamentally important, we think, to the future of our economic agenda, both across the Atlantic, but also in a post-Brexit world, as you say. Mm-hmm. We formally began negotiating in early May this year. We always knew we couldn't begin negotiating until we had left the EU, which finally happened on the 31st of January this year. We've now had two rounds. We're making good, solid progress, and it remains a top priority for the government.
Any kind of a timetable? I imagine it might be a little difficult to determine at this point, what with our presidential election just a few months ahead.
I think the way I've always felt about this is we should try and make as much progress as we can, as fast as we can. There will be things that happen in the outside world that are beyond our control. Obviously, the COVID crisis was also one of those things that delayed our start until early May. Otherwise, I'm pretty sure we would have started around about the middle of March, maybe late March. But I've always also felt that the best way to guarantee that we can't make progress is not to try. So let's go for this as fast as we can. That's what the negotiating teams are doing, and we will see how we get on.
Which sectors of UK trade do you believe hold particular promise for growth right now, specifically in the case of UK-US trade, but maybe in a larger sense as well?
I think it's really important to see it in that larger sense, actually, because I think what the UK and US can do with each other also has global relevance, including whether we can, if we are able, for example, to establish gold standard rules in intellectual property protection or digital trade, then we can take that into the global conversations in places like the G7, the G20, the OECD, and set the terms of the future of the global economy in a way that suits the interests of our two economies. Bilaterally, though, I think this is about two very advanced, quite highly services-oriented economies, but with real strengths in advanced manufacturing, life sciences, financial services, digital trade, as I've mentioned, I think is going to be a fundamentally important part of this. And above all, it's about how do we deepen and strengthen that economic relationship that I've mentioned is already so strong. For the UK, it's also an important part of our economic recovery plan to the economic impact of the COVID crisis. Prime Minister talks about building back better, understanding the impact and building the resilience into our supply chains and our economy across all parts of the United Kingdom. And so, you know, the sectors that we will want to focus on, I've touched on a few of them, but I would also add agriculture, automotive, chemicals. You know, these are the future of our economy. They're the future of the US economy, and there's a chance to take that forward together.
I imagine you'd be especially keen on technology growing at 2.6 times the rate of other sectors of the UK economy right now. So that's got to be foremost, or at least at the forefront of your negotiations, right?
Absolutely, absolutely. And, you know, the last few years, including the most recent couple of years, the UK has been phenomenally successful at attracting tech-related investment into the UK, outstripping our European partners put together. We have some of the most important clusters of tech development in Europe. We have some of the largest number of unicorns being created in the UK over the last few years. And the challenge, I think, for us, and this is certainly one that we're very focused on realizing and meeting, is how do we create those conditions for the future so that people keep having the confidence to put those both large-scale investments, but also, you know, little startups coming and having the confidence to invest and locate in the UK and make us their platform for really driving forward their business plans for the future.
Mm-hmm. You talk about intellectual protection. We don't hear too much about IP being an issue between the UK and the US or between Europe and the US. I imagine it is a concern, but mostly it comes up in trade between the US and China, maybe the UK and China as well. Is it in fact something that we need to be concerned about in this particular trade lane?
So I don't think it is. I think this is a very good example, as I touched on, that where the UK and US already have very high standards of intellectual property protection. So there aren't really any bilateral issues of friction there. But what we need to do is think about how we handle IP issues in a global context. So how do we address concerns about technology transfer abuses in other countries? How do we make sure that we have the right framework in a world that's going to be increasingly dominated by tech, increasingly dominated by digital trade, as we look to bring in, you know, the real advances that artificial intelligence, quantum, other transformational dynamics within our economies, you know, where are we going to set the rules and the frameworks that will allow us to make sure that those issues are fairly, progressively, transparently regulated in order to encourage innovation, but at the same time to understand people's concerns about privacy or people's concerns about the ethics of some of these issues. And within that, to your point, how we can make sure that companies who invest in IP can really turn that into a commercial proposition. I think the UK and the US are already leading the world on this, but we can do more together in a broader global context.
You speak about the negotiation of the bilateral agreement with the US, as well as seeking additional bilateral agreements with other countries. But then you also said the possibility of joining the TPP. Going forward, do you think that we might see more of an emphasis between trading partners on bilaterals as opposed to multilateral agreements? Or will there continue to be both types of instruments in trade negotiations?
I think from a UK perspective, we want to see both. We want to use our voice in the WTO to push forward at the most multilateral level to have a conversation about trade liberalization, about enhancing trade and investment between nations. We think that creates better jobs, higher paid jobs, greater quality of life, more opportunity for consumers to access a higher range of quality, competitively priced goods, et cetera, et cetera. Mm-hmm. The WTO, though, has had some issues in the previous sort of, maybe since the launch of the Doha round in the early 2000s. And so there's been more of a focus on plurilateral agreements, including some coming through the WTO. And we're very keen supporters of what they're trying to do on e-commerce, for example, at the minute, as well as the web of bilaterals that have been pushed forward by various countries and where the UK also has its ambitions, as we've talked about.
Are you seeking any kind of reforms within the WTO as with regard to policy? Or do you think just as an organization as it now exists, it's still effective?
I think we believe it is still effective, but we do believe that it has to also have a reform agenda in order to continue to secure public consent for the way it operates, to continue to be a leading voice at a global level, building support for trade liberalization, setting out clear, well understood, transparent rules, managing, you know, if we go back to some of the debates that we've seen as a result of the COVID crisis, where lots of countries, for very legitimate reasons, clamped down on exports of particular products. There are rules in the WTO that permit for that, but say that they should be temporary and transparent. So we think the WTO has a really crucial role, but it clearly needs to keep reforming, to keep itself relevant, to make sure that it is seen and trusted to be fit for purpose. We think it is, but we think that there is more we can do, and we want to work with allies, including the US, the EU, Japan, working with Canada and others who are having really important conversations about the future of the WTO.
This is a critical time for the UK to be redefining its trade ties with its trading partners because of the Brexit situation. But I'm wondering if you have any concern about, number one, of course, the COVID-19 pandemic, but even when that's over, a global recession that will follow and could last for some time. Do you have some concern about how those two particular trends might be helping to put the brakes on the UK's efforts to solidify new trade ties with partners?
I think the way I would look at it is sort of what we were saying a second ago, that there are things that are going to happen in the global economy that are beyond our control. No one would have invited or maybe even expected or anticipated the economic crisis that we have seen as a result of the global pandemic. Although as someone, I was on another panel this morning, and someone, I thought quite rightly, and I hadn't really thought of it this way, remarked that normally you have an economic crisis, it sort of does damage to fundamental parts of the economy. With COVID, what we have seen is because of the enforced lockdown, all of the sort of the infrastructure of the global economy is still there. And what we need to do now is to continue to understand the impact of the pandemic, continue to manage the balance between the benefits of economic reopening, but also the risks of that, meaning a resurgence of the virus. At the same time, as I said earlier, thinking about what we have learned about our economies, the vulnerabilities within it, the vulnerabilities within our supply chain. We also, from a UK point of view, I would just note, fundamentally important that we come back in a way that is more sustainable, that is consistent with our broader ambitions on the climate agenda, in terms of ensuring that we remain on a path towards net zero by 2050. We need to do all of that in a global economic context. And, you know, economies can't do this on their own. The UK is an open, engaged global economy. We want to have conversations with our partners and with our allies in all the fora that we can find in order to push this conversation in that general direction.
And again, just to circle back finally to the UK and the United States and your own trade relationship. So you are saying that negotiations for a new bilateral agreement continue apace, that they are actually, there's you expect progress to be made this year, and that there's actually action on that front.
As I said, we are pushing this as fast as we can. We've had two formal rounds, but we were not resting on our laurels in between the rounds. There were over 20 intersessional meetings between the negotiating teams between rounds one and two. The third round will begin around about the end of this month, and we will again be using the time between now and then to continue to put in place the building blocks for that formal negotiation to see if we can make as much progress as fast as we can.
Commissioner Antony Phillipson, thank you so much for taking the time to speak with me today.
My pleasure. Thank you.